the moon mission is the cause of great confusion. You know? So, you know, when I was introduced to Krishna Bhakti, there was one friend also was introduced with me, very intelligent person. And he started coming, the program used to happen at my room itself, and he used to come and we used to have a lot of discussions. But when he heard in a class that we did not go to the moon, it was like for him it was yad gatvan anivartante after that. He stopped coming. And I was very concerned about it. And then over the years I studied this topic more, I talked with various senior devotees, and I discovered how oversimplified and almost distorted many of the statements that we make about the moon mission are. So here I'll give you some samples of how diverse Prabhupada's statements about the moon were. Most often we will hear, Prabhupada said, man did not go to the moon. But that's only one of the many different kinds of statements that Prabhupada has made. And I'll talk later about why this particular statement became highlighted. But yes, so maybe there are many statements. Different devotees could read one statement now. Can you go ahead? So I'll discuss these three things. Prabhupada's statements. Then we'll talk about what might have happened with respect to the moon mission. And then we will discuss how we can avoid distraction from devotion. Go ahead, please. Yeah, who would like to read?
Illegal immigration, temporary.
The moon. So in the top, I have summarized what the main point that Prabhupada is making is given over there. Yeah, go ahead.
The moon planet. From the Shastra, we understand that nobody can go there unless he is fit. Just like to enter into some foreign country, you have to take visa. You have to take passport, immigration. Then you will be allowed. So such attempt to go there, and even if you go there, you will be driven away. So what is the use of such attempt?
Yeah, you can read the, where also Prabhupada spoke.
Lecture on Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto, 5th chapter, 5th verse, Stockholm, September 10, 1973.
Yes. So, Prabhupada is here comparing the various parts of the universe to sovereign nations. And we cannot just gatecrash into those nations. That's the point that Srila Prabhupada makes over here. So, if you see the thrust of his reasoning is very significant and specific. So, that you cannot enter because there is illegal immigration. Then go ahead. We will not be able to go there. It will only be temporary. And then another statement. Yes, Balram.
Went, but couldn't stay there.
Yeah.
And practically we see they are going to the moon planet, but they cannot stay. Uselessly going and coming. Lecture on Srimad Bhagavatam 6.1.1-4, Melbourne, May 20th, 1975.
Yes. So here, Prabhupada is not denying that they went to the moon. They're going and coming. What's the big deal? So what is the use of, what is the utility of it all? And this utility point is very significant because initially when the moon mission was touted, it was at one level an ego battle between the two countries which are having the Cold War, Britain, USA and USSR. Another point was that there was a lot of hope that in the future we might have colonies on the moon. And then we could emigrate to the moon also. We could live on the moon. I said, if we can't emigrate, at least we could have tourism to the moon. If we can't have tourism to the moon, at least we'll have mining on the moon. And we'll fight. But once they went there, they went a few times, after that, none of the things happened. Leave alone emigration, there is no mine, there is no tourism, no space tourism, there is no mining also. So, no further things happened. Now, the enthusiasm is, let's go to the Mars. But the original reasons which were driving it, they are not being talked about. So, Prabhupada is making this point. Okay, what did you get? Even if you went there, what did you get there? So, here the emphasis is not that you didn't go there at all. You went, but what is the utility? Can you go ahead? Yes, so.
Can we go there by spacecraft? With their advanced consciousness, human beings are naturally inclined to travel in outer space and to reach other planets, either by spaceships, mystic powers, or demigod worship. In the Vedic scriptures, it is said that one can reach other planets by any one of these three ways. But the most common way is by worshipping the demigod presiding over a particular planet. Purport, Isha Upanishad 12.
Yes. So here, Prabhupada is not denying the possibility of going even by spacecraft. Three ways: worship of the devatas, the getting some mystic powers, and spacecraft. So now, one of the first books that Srila Prabhupada wrote was Easy Journey to Other Planets. And you know, whom did Prabhupada dedicate that book to? It is dedicated to the scientists of the world.
It is not dedicated to his spiritual master. It's dedicated to the scientists of the world. And
in that book, if you read it, Prabhupada's tone is not at all confrontational. It says, you have discovered antimatter. And Prabhupada very creatively says, antimatter, if it is anti, all its properties will be opposite to that of matter. The current scientific understanding is that there's antimatter. Matter and antimatter unite, it's like -1 + 1 will become 0. So both will get destroyed. But Prabhupada says, actually antimatter would be what? If matter is temporary, antimatter would be eternal. And that antimaterial particle is described in the Bhagavad Gita, that is the Atma. And Prabhupada uses that as a segue to talk about the Bhagavad Gita's concepts. And he also talks about, because at that time, there is fascination with space travel. It had not happened. It happened in 1969 when Prabhupada was in America. But the fascination was there. And there also Prabhupada, in Easy Journey to Other Planets, Prabhupada doesn't condemn or deny the possibility of going to the moon or to other planets. He says, okay, you want to go, but what is the point? You go there, you'll have to come back. Prabhupada also says in one of his lectures that when he wrote this book, and then there's a prominent scientist, he said, Swami, with Vedic technology, we can go to the moon? He says, yes, we can go to the moon, we can go to the sun, we can go to wherever we want. Then he said, the next question he asks, can we come back? I said, why do you want to come back? That's a much better place. He said, no, can we come back? So Prabhupada would give this sometimes as an example of how, you know, we might be so attached. Even if we go to a higher place, we want to come back. So the point is, Prabhupada did not consider that at that stage, he did not deny the possibility of going to a higher planet. He said, there is a better way to go there. So we cannot bracket Prabhupada or reduce him to one approach. Prabhupada used different approaches at different times. There were times, of course, when he made confrontational statements. But there are times when he made non-confrontational statements also. So, he's acknowledging the possibility here of going by spacecraft. So, two things. He said, they may have gone. And now he says, okay, they may have gone by spacecraft also. Go ahead. And there is another possibility. Yes, who would like to read?
They were diverted elsewhere. Moon planet is heavenly planet. Heavenly planet. There, demigods, they live. So, we get this information. Or just like, if somebody comes to this earthly planet and drops in the Arabian desert, he may conclude that this is desert, but there is Europe, America, and nice cities and nice bungalows, but he has no chance to see them. So, these people are going.
So, now, in this divergence, he talks about two distinct things. One is that somebody comes to the earth, but they are sent to an uninhabited part of the earth and they don't see anything over there. So that means they could be diverted on moon to a particular area where they don't see anything, or they may be diverted away from the moon itself elsewhere. Go ahead.
They were diverted elsewhere. They had no chance. Maybe they are also diverting them to the deserted portion of the moon. They were also intelligent.
They refer to the
whom?
Moon. Yes. The residents of the moon. When they say, hey, UFO, is unidentified flying object, has come over here. Send it away.
So like that. Go ahead.
That these people are coming from earthly planet unauthorized. So let them divert it to the deserted portion. There are so many things. So therefore, because if moon planet is heavenly planet, they are more intelligent than you.
Yeah, they are more intelligent than you. They can divert you. Can you go ahead? It's a long quote, but this illustrates Prabhupada's overall tenor of thought. Yeah.
If you have got some machine to reach there, they have got some machine to divert you. Why not think like that? That these rascals are coming here without any immigration license. Let them be diverted to the deserted portion, and disappointed, they will go back. Lecture on Nectar of Devotion, Bombay, December 28th, 1972.
Yeah, thank you. So, let them be diverted somewhere else. Go ahead. Now, of course, this is the standard what we often hear, but that's one statement Prabhupada made. Yeah, go ahead, please.
Hoax in the laboratory. Devotee. Prabhupada, when they said they went to the moon and they showed films of them landing and walking on the moon, was this all a bluff? Prabhupada. Yes. Here they, all laboratory work, that's all. Devotee. They all made it up? Prabhupada. Yes. Morning walk, June 2nd, 1975, Honolulu.
Yeah. Now this brings us to an interesting point that, you know, sometimes Prabhupada used certain empirical sources. And if those empirical sources also spoke some point, which was, in his view, in harmony with scripture, then he would quote those empirical sources. So, but later on, if that empirical source was proven to be not so trustworthy, Prabhupada would stop quoting that. So when Prabhupada was in America, there was the people who read many different books. So once somebody came to him and Prabhupada, somebody came to Prabhupada and they gave him a book called the Aquarian Gospel. And the Aquarian Gospel is a book which describes how Jesus, it describes many things. One of the things it describes is Jesus' lost years. So in the life of Jesus, certain years where he was, it's not known at all. And different people have different theories. So in that Aquarian Gospel, it is said that he traveled eastward and he came to India, he came to Jagannath Puri. And Prabhupada quoted that one, Prabhupada read that and Prabhupada quoted that in the class. And then now Rajendra Swarup Prabhu was one of the most scholarly disciples of Srila Prabhupada. He said, Prabhupada, this Aquarian Gospel, is this authorized? So Prabhupada said, isn't it? It's a gospel, isn't it? No, Prabhupada, that's just the Prabhupada, that's just the name. It's a later book written in the 17th, 18th century. That's what the historians say. And the Catholic Church also doesn't accept it as a part of the gospel. So Prabhupada said, he asked, I thought it is part of the gospel. Prabhupada, is it good? Prabhupada said, that part of Jesus coming to Puri, that is good.
Yeah.
But interestingly, after that, Prabhupada stopped quoting that book. So, sometimes Prabhupada would quote certain things which seem to support the broad Vedic understanding. So, our Vedic understanding is that ultimately, all the messengers or sons or whoever comes and raises God consciousness, they are ultimately coming from God. So, if that could be vindicated from some, that could be confirmed from the empirical source, Prabhupada would quote that. But Prabhupada would not give too much weight on that empirical source, because the empirical source can sometimes be authoritative, sometimes it need not be authoritative. So, there is even now it's in the Lila Amrit, where Prabhupada says that by 2000, there will be so much pollution on the earth that nobody will be able to live on the surface of the earth. Everybody will have to live underground like rats. By 2000. Now 2000 has come and gone. We are not living exactly like underground like rats. So now when I read this for the first time, I was first time I read Lila Amrut, it was just so ecstatic. I didn't even notice it. But when I read that at the future times, then one of the times it just stood out to me. It was a little disturbing. But then I checked with devotees. So I checked with Nagaraj, who is the BTG editor. Often I ask him some. So he went back and 2 days before, when Prabhupada spoke this, there was a morning walk. And in that morning walk, somebody had told Prabhupada a report of some environmental protection society, meteorological society, and they had said that by 2000, nobody will be able to walk on the surface of the earth. So Prabhupada is simply quoting an empirical source. And Prabhupada's point is, say, don't get so excited about this material progress and material advancement. Focus on spiritual growth. Don't think this is going to solve all your problems. So if some empirical source could support that, Prabhupada would quote that. But now, unfortunately, the way it is put in Lila Amrita is Prabhupada is making a prophecy. By 2000, nobody will be able to walk on the surface of the earth. So when I had mentioned this to Ravindra Swarup Prabhu, he made a striking point. He said, Prabhupada was not in the prophecy business. So Prabhupada didn't make prophecies like that. There's a story of Prabhupada also talking about third world war happening. But Prabhupada was told by certain people third world war may happen, and Prabhupada used that in his preaching too. And actually there was a lot of fear that third world war might happen. Between the Cuban Missile Crisis was there, and other times when the USSR and USA were at loggerheads. So it could well have happened. So now, at that time, on one side, there was a lot of excitement and national pride. When the moon mission happened and the moon landing is said to have happened. But along with that, from that time onwards, from 1969 onwards, there have been some skeptics. Some skeptics who doubted it. And there are some movies, there are some documentaries made about it, books written about it. And it's something which is, there are many, several movies made about it. Then NASA and other scientists have refuted those also. Then somebody has refuted their refutations also. And they have refuted their refutations. So it's like Tarko Apratishta Shrutayo Vibhinna. It's just going on. So at that time, in general, if you see, those people who were attracted to our movement in the 1960s, most of them were anti-establishment. Now the hippies themselves were counterculture, they were anti-establishment. And the things that the mainstream was proud of, they mocked it. It's all worthless. So in that sense, the overall tenor of the people who were coming to our movement was of people who were skeptical of mainstream society. Mainstream society's claims, its claims of progress, its claims of advancement, its claims of prosperity. And that was the demographic that came to Prabhupada at that time. And when Prabhupada was interacting with people, especially in the Western world, the way Prabhupada operated was, in India, he knew the ground realities. And that's why once the movement started expanding in India, Prabhupada made his base here. And most of the American preaching, he delegated it to his Western disciples. And he would just once a year or twice a year, he would visit. And they would expand the preaching. But in India, he was hands-on there. So, many of the statements that Srila Prabhupada made, they were in response to what was presented to him. So, when Prabhupada makes a particular statement in response to what is presented to him, that statement can't be absolutized as Prabhupada's only position. Because Prabhupada has made different statements at different times. And we have examples of, when Prabhupada was, I gave two examples of how Prabhupada, when the information was told, one example of course, Aquarian Gospel, told not, this is not authority, Prabhupada stopped using it. There is also the famous incident of Prabhupada doing a book distribution that and some devotees told Prabhupada that for expanding book distribution, if we wear civil clothes, instead of the devotee clothes, that would be better. And Prabhupada said, yes, if you're distributing books more, that's fine. But then somebody told Prabhupada that actually, in the name of wearing civil clothes, people are going back to their hippie ways. And Prabhupada said, this is nonsense. Stop it. Stop it, he said. And then several of the leading book distributors, they immediately flew to India and they told Prabhupada that actually, if we stop wearing civil clothes, our book distribution will go down by half. Because people, they just feel alien, they feel very strange when they're talking with somebody in a strange dress. And they said, Prabhupada, they're not wearing disheveled clothes. They're actually wearing respectable clothes that can attract people to them. And Prabhupada said, oh, I thought they're going back to their hippie ways, means they're going back to the hippie lifestyle, hippie dress, everything in the name of distributing books. If they're dressing respectably, that's fine. Then I don't have any objection to that. So, this is also another example of how Prabhupada responded to the information that was presented to him. So, during that time, the demographic that was coming to our movement was a demographic that was highly skeptical of mainstream society. And the information that was presented to him was often centered on skepticism to everything that the mainstream society claimed was great. So, the moon mission was also that was a great accomplishment of mainstream society. And those who were in the counterculture, they were skeptical of that. So Prabhupada made certain statements in response to what was presented to him. And this is one example. So this devotee is quoting about that documentary and yes, it's like that Prabhupada is saying. Go ahead. Now again, another quote, but same point. That he didn't get. Yeah, go ahead.
Went but didn't get much of it. It is not like that after spending many millions of dollars, you go to the moon planet and touch it and bring some sand. And you are satisfied. You see, don't waste in that. If you go, live there. Lecture on Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto, 5th chapter, 2nd chapter.
Yes. So, thank you. So, Prabhupada is making, okay, what is, so here he's talking more in terms of the financial investment returns. What is the, you're spending millions of dollars, what are you getting out of it? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Now, this is, I would say, one of the most important statements which indicates Prabhupada's overall mood. Yeah.
Endeavor for spiritual elevation, not material elevation. Modern man has struggled very hard to reach the moon, but he has not tried very hard to elevate himself spiritually. If one has 50 years of life ahead of him, he should engage that brief time in cultivating this practice of remembering the Supreme Personality of a Godhead. Introduction, Bhagavad Gita as it is.
Yeah, so this is right in the introduction, Prabhupada is saying this, that he's not saying that whether we go to the moon or not. Okay, you endeavored so much for that. Why not endeavor a little bit for this? And there, Prabhupada is not in any ways condemning that or even judging that. He's just taking that as a impetus for inspiration and redirection of efforts. Yeah, can you go ahead? So, now this is a complicated issue and there's no definitive answer. But when Prabhupada has made many different statements on one issue, then we cannot take one statement as his sole authoritative statement. So to say that Prabhupada said we didn't go to the moon, yes, that's true. But that was not the only thing that he said. He said many different things also. So now if we look at the various statements he has made, we can, which is the most important statement if you want to say, well, we don't know. He has made all those statements. But one way we can understand which is most important is, which statement resonates with his overall message? The Prabhupada's central message was he didn't care whether man went to the moon or not. The Prabhupada didn't go from Vrindavan to America to tell Americans you didn't go to the moon. You know, he went to them to tell them how they can go to Krishna. So how they can make spiritual advancement. So we focus on that position that fulfills Prabhupada's purpose the most. Prabhupada started a society, international society for refuting moon hoax, for moon conspiracy. No, that's not our purpose. The international society for Krishna consciousness. So that means among the various positions that Prabhupada has taken, in our outreach, we can present or highlight that position which fulfills Prabhupada's ultimate purpose. That position which helps people to come to Krishna or to rise toward Krishna consciousness. If anything else is distracting people from the spiritual world, from spiritual growth, then there is no need to highlight that position. And again, no need to make that as an issue of faith. Now, why we are talking this in the cosmology section? See, in the cosmology section, there is description of different planets and different planetary motions. But in the Shastra itself, there is no normative or definitive statement that one cannot go to a higher planet. It is said that one cannot go in a normal means. The normal means is, as Prabhupada says, you have to acquire the proper visa, the proper immigration status, and then you go there. Now, then the question may come up, then what actually happened? Yeah, can you go ahead? So, before we go into that. So, if you say that, okay, those who don't have punya, how can they go to heavens? Well, in the Shastra also, there are some examples of people gate-crashing into heaven. That the asuras, when they attack, now the asuras are not going by doing punya. The asuras are going by their brute prowess. And they are, we might say, okay, they've done some austerities and that's how they got some powers. But that austerity is not exactly the same as punya for going toward heaven. So, but they are able to go there. So, Ravana tries to go there. And then Ravana actually goes there and he is defeated. And he's arrested by Indra. And then Indrajit, Meghanath goes there and rescues him. And he turns the tables around. He arrests Indra. Then Brahmaji, and he actually brings Indra as a prisoner to Lanka. Then Brahmaji comes and says, please release him, otherwise the universal order will be disrupted. Then Indrajit asks for some special benedictions from him. So Ravana is able to go to heaven. Hiranyakashipu also terrorizes the devatas. We see in the 8th canto, the devatas are dispossessed of heavens, and that's why Diti is in great distress, and then she prays, please arrange some relief, and then Vamanadeva comes. So there are examples of people without doing the requisite punya to go to heaven, but that is a quasi-stable stage. They go there for some time, they disrupt the universal order and go there, and then they are eventually evicted out of there. So modern people are definitely not as powerful as the past asuras. So they cannot go and take over the heavens, but they might go there for some time. Go ahead. Now, by certain prowess, what to speak of going to Swargaloka? Somebody can go to Vaikuntha also. Durvasa Muni goes to Vaikuntha when he is being chased by the Sudarshan Chakra. But then, going to Vaikuntha is not just a matter of, like, say, transportation or physical relocation. It's a matter of consciousness. Otherwise, he may go there, but he can't stay there and he doesn't even want to stay there. So then that going is not really going. Yeah. Now, specifically by mechanical devices, we have in the Mahabharata, as Arjuna goes to Swarga, and he goes to Swarga with the chariot which Indra has sent through Maithili through him. And then he goes in the physical form of the earth and he sits Mahadasanartham. The Bhagavatam says that Indra has him seat on his own throne. So half of the throne Indra occupies, half of the throne Arjuna occupies. So there is the possibility of going in this body itself to heavens. So then now I talked about Prabhupada's statements and what Shastra says. And now we'll look at what might have happened with respect to the moon mission. So broadly, we could say that the humans went to a 3D projection of Chandraloka. I'll explain what I mean by that. Or there was a high-tech diversion, as Prabhupada says, by the devatas, and they went somewhere else. Or they didn't go out of the earth at all. Everything was hoaxed. So anything could have happened. Now, what do we mean by a 2D projection of a 3D object? What do I mean by projection? See, basically, the heavenly planets exist at a higher level of reality. Like we discussed in our previous session, when everybody in India and America will say heaven is up, but up is two opposite directions. So what's up? So it is which direction is up? So it's a subtle thing. So when we say it's subtle means what? It exists at a different level of reality. It exists at different dimensions. So even if we could travel in 3D space to heavens, we won't access the reality that is heaven. Because heaven is, and Chandraloka is also considered part of the heavenly planets. So it is existing at a different level of reality. So if we had can we go to the next slide? I'll explain this afterward. Yeah. So if we have a map. So a map, we could say, is like a 2D projection of a multidimensional object. So there is Mumbai and there is Pune. Say if I'm in Mumbai, and on a map, I move my finger from Mumbai to Pune. I'm not going to experience anything about Pune. I might say, I went to Pune. Okay, your finger went to the location that corresponds to Pune on the map. But you're not experienced anything about Pune. So, just having the technology to transport to a particular place doesn't mean that we have got access to higher levels of reality. So it could be that they went to the moon, but they didn't access the moon because we've gone with the gross body. And with the gross body, we'll only see the gross realities. And this is that, what to speak of, we going to the heavens, even if the devatas come to the earth, we cannot see the devatas unless they grant us the vision. They grant us the vision. Many times when the sacrifices are performed, the sacrifice at the end of the fire sacrifice, the devatas come and accept the sacrificial offering. But most of the times, the performance of sacrifice don't see the devatas. It's only when they are specially pleased that they grant that vision and they are able to see. So, we might have gone like that in 3D space to the moon, but we didn't access any of the higher reality that is the moon. Yeah. Can you go ahead? So now, if you want to take a math analogy, 3 plus 3 is 6. If somebody says 3 plus 3 is not 6, then they are wrong. If somebody, we give them somebody an assignment, we'll do 3 plus 3. And what is your answer? Is it 6? No, it's not 6. Now, what is the answer? Now you can get one from infinite numbers. You can have any answer. If it is not 6, we know it is wrong. But what is the specific answer that they got, that particular person might have got? It can be infinite possibilities. So like that, if somebody goes to moon and doesn't experience the higher reality that is the moon, doesn't experience it as Swargaloka, that means something went wrong. Now what exactly went wrong, that we don't know. So as cosmonauts have not experienced Chandraloka with all its opulence, that means they have not got 3 plus 3 is 6. So they have missed out something. And Prabhupada's point was that you cannot, it's a heavenly planet, you cannot access heaven without the right karma. So you can go, maybe they can go physically, but that doesn't mean they experience, they have actually entered into Swargaloka. This is something similar to somebody going to Vrindavan, but they don't really see Vrindavan much. I'll talk about that in tomorrow's class, but that is the broad principle. Now, the last point in this discussion about the moon mission, our focus should be that we avoid people from getting distracted from devotion and the growth in devotion. Go ahead. So now if we consider what is the essence of preaching, when we are trying to share Krishna Bhakti with others, say if Krishna is there and there is some, this wall is like an obstacle between people and Krishna. So the preacher's job is to break this wall. So to remove obstacles on the path of people to come to Krishna. Now, at particular time in history, the excitement, oh, we went to the moon, we are going to go to the moon, something wonderful is going to happen, we are going to conquer space. That excitement was a big distraction for people. So can you go ahead? Yeah. So we will go to the moon, we are going to the moon, we have gone to the moon. There was so much elation and that was distracting people from devotion in the 1960s, 1970s. And Prabhupada's whole mood was, don't get excited about it so much. Sometimes he said, you didn't go to the moon, they went elsewhere, they were diverted, whatever. Don't get so excited about it. So what is the obstacle? We have to remove that obstacle. So if there is too much excitement about something, don't get so excited about it. Now, at least in today's world, what I have seen is, the obstacle is something different. Can you go next slide? It's a different statement. So today, if people hear, we haven't gone to the moon, that is what agitates them. What do you mean you say we didn't go to the moon? Till they hear it, they don't care much about it. But as soon as they hear it, you claim like this. That means I'll have to believe this, if we didn't go to the moon. So the moon mission is not at all an issue for people in their Krishna bhakti till we make it an issue. So, why make it an issue? Isn't it? So, it's irrelevant. You know, yeah, okay, we read in our books, we went to the moon. And so, for many people, see, what happens is, many people don't know science much. Many people are not very scientific. But they like to believe and claim, I am scientific. And especially, if they are told that to come to spirituality, you have to stop being scientific or you reject science. That becomes very difficult for them. That becomes very difficult. So, there was this devotee friend of mine. Well, I could say, he's a devotee. He was a friend. He was a semi-devotee. He was coming up. And he got a job in ISRO. ISRO. So, Indian Space Research Organization. And in ISRO, he started preaching, man did not go to the moon. So, it was one of the most ridiculous things you could do. And apparently his boss was actually Sri Vaishnava. And his boss called him and told him, that, you know, I also read the Bhagavatam. We also worship Krishna. We also are Krishna Bhaktas. But we don't make this an issue. Now, where does the Bhagavatam say that you can't go to the moon? So then he asked the devotees. He asked whatever devotees he knew, he asked them, where does the Bhagavatam say it can't go to the moon? So he says, you know, if that person is saying like this, that person is damaging your faith in Prabhupada. Stop associating with him. He's a non-devotee. That's what he was told. So then, sometimes, see, all over the world, when somebody takes to a particular path, there is what is called the zeal of the new convert. Zeal of the new convert means, I know the truth and I'm going to deliver and enlighten everyone. That's the idea. So he tried to argue with his boss, and he got into a lot of trouble because of that. Then eventually he wrote to me on my website, and then we had a long discussion, and I presented him various statements of Prabhupada. And then he calmed down. He realized this is not an issue. This is, in English, there is saying that, like, say if two armies are fighting a war, and there is some minor fort or hill, which if you lose it, it doesn't matter. No, you can always, that is not such an important hill for you. So they say, this is not the hill I want to die on. What do you mean? This is not a big battle for us. Our big battle is how to get people to come to Krishna. So we don't have to make this a faith issue or make this a central issue in our preaching. Can you go ahead? So when we have to do outreach, we have to look at which statements remove obstacles. We have to make those statements which will remove the obstacles for people, not make statements that will become obstacles for people. So, na buddhi bhedam janayet, Krishna says, don't disturb people's minds. And there he is saying, even if those people are attached and ignorant, don't disturb their minds, elevate them gradually. Na buddhi bhedam janayet agyanam karma sangina josheet sarva karmani vidvan yuktah samacharan. Elevate them, Krishna is saying. And now here we don't even know actually what happened. Prabhupada has not taken one position. So why make that an issue at all? Can you go ahead? So now, in many ways, today's technological advancement, it is like mystic power. Prabhupada talks about this in the Nectar of Devotion introduction. How the various siddhis, modern man has achieved that in some ways. You know, we can penetrate into stone or something by tunnels. We can fly into the sky using planes. That's like anima, mahima, laghima. Prabhupada gives like a generic comparison of those siddhis. And Prabhupada's point in the Nectar of Devotion is that actually this technology is nothing to be excited about. The siddhis are also nothing to be excited about. So now today's mystic power, just as there are mystic powers in the past, technology is in some way like a mystic power. Now go ahead. Whether today's technology can do everything that mystic powers could do or not, that's open to question. Mystic powers might be able to do certain things more, technology might be able to do certain things different. But the key thing is, just as in our tradition, go ahead, that mystic power is understood to be a distraction, similarly, technology can also be a distraction. So Prabhupada's point is, don't get distracted by technological accomplishments. Just as by yogic accomplishments, don't get distracted. So similar technological accomplishment, don't get distracted. So, you know, we have distraction. Device. So, device means, what happens is, if we have a device and we don't have devotion, then we end up with vice. So, device minus devotion, you remove the D. So, we can get distracted by technology in so many ways in today's world. So, we just have to avoid distraction. Go ahead. So, Sarva Vidhi Nishidasur Etayarayo Kinkaram. Smartavya Satan Vishnu Vistavartmatyam na Jatu Chit. Always remember Krishna, never forget Krishna. Yeah. So, now in general, there is a, rather than thinking of faithfulness to Guru Sadhu Shastra as, like, one position has to be followed. There could be an acceptable range of positions. So, one acceptable range would be that astronauts went to the moon, but they didn't access the moon. The other would be, they didn't go out of the earth at all. The devotees can have any of these positions. And all these positions could be based on Prabhupada's statements. So we can take any position. But which position should we take? See, our purpose is not whether they went to the moon or they didn't go. Our purpose is whether we keep moving toward Krishna and we help others to move toward Krishna. So we take the position which helps us and others to move toward Krishna. And rather than saying this person is faithful and this person is not faithful, this person is serious and this person is loose, they don't have to get in that. Which we have to be, we can be pragmatic with respect to this. Whatever helps us move toward Krishna. So whether anyone went to the moon or not, we can, by Krishna's mercy, go beyond the moon to Goloka. And that is Prabhupada's real gift that he has given us. So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.